We're reaching the end of a really crazy year, and we've been living through a pandemic and multiple crises. My question is, how do we want to be remembered? I hope by the end of this and my talk, you see this question the way I do, which is truly existential. Throughout COVID, we've heard the word unprecedented used frequently to describe our experience, suggesting that we've never been through a viral pandemic before, but we have. So the word unprecedented is simply an excuse and justification for our own inaction and ineffective leadership. Throughout history, our behavior as humans during viral pandemics has been less than humane. In the mid-1300s, parents in Florence were described as abandoning their children on the streets in order to save themselves. In the mid-1600s, Londoners were said to neglect their family and neighbors. During the 1918 pandemic, health workers in Philadelphia were unable to find volunteers to take food to children and adults who were in quarantine. They were left to starve. In March 2020, the columnist David Brooks described these events and also noted that by the end of World War I, 53,000 Americans had died. And the country celebrated the victory and sacrifice by talking about it, writing plays, writing books, and making movies. He said they did this because they were proud of how they behaved. And by contrast, he said, by the end of the 1918 pandemic, 675,000 Americans had died. And the country didn't talk about it. There were no books or plays written. He posited that this happened because people were ashamed of how they behaved and wanted to put the experience in the past. Can you imagine abandoning your children, neglecting neighbors and families, allowing people to starve? It's hard to imagine in our society that that might happen. But we've seen mass hoarding, people ignoring medical advice, rebellion against social distancing and mask wearing, and an increase in food insecurity, with 1 in 8 families not having access to enough food. It seems as though we've completely abandoned our own civic responsibilities and forgotten to think of each other as humans. How will we be remembered? We've been living through another pandemic, which is slow moving, which makes it difficult to see and hard to comprehend. That pandemic is climate change. And throughout discussions of climate change, we've also heard the word unprecedented used frequently to describe our experience, suggesting that we haven't known that this is happening. But we have known because scientists have been warning us for over 100 years that our behavior impacts our climate. So again, the word unprecedented is simply an excuse and justification for our own inaction and ineffective leadership. But there is no excuse because we know this is real, we know the impacts, we have the solutions and just need to implement them. And yet, we seem unwilling to make meaningful change. We all need to make change. And we should decide, how do we want to be remembered? Do we want to be remembered as people who abandoned their children, neglected families and neighbors? As people who allowed our community to starve, all in pursuit of our own self-interest? Or do we want to be remembered as people who were willing to sacrifice and make the meaningful change necessary to improve the lives of our children, our families, neighbors, and the entire global community? We all need to change our behavior. None of this is difficult. Few examples require radical change. And I'm not suggesting that any of us need to become vegetarian, or all of us don't need to become vegetarian. Although, in full disclosure, I am a vegetarian, and it's really quite nice. Through my work as a social and environmental impact consultant, I'd like to propose that there are two ways we can think about making meaningful change as individuals and have a positive impact on our climate. These two ideas are use less and care more. So what do I mean by use less? Americans are rabid consumers. We consume more than any other country in the world on both a national and individual basis. and all of that consumption has significant environmental and community impacts. We can start by looking at our water use. The way we use waters in our houses and as individuals have significant impacts on the environment in our communities, particularly downstream communities. The United States Geological Survey indicates that Spokane is in the top 2% of water use per person per day. And that might seem hard to imagine, but I'll give you an example of my own family. Last summer, we were using around 70,000 gallons of water a day. Sorry, a month, which is a huge amount, and most of it went to keeping our yard green. That's enough water to hydrate 150 people for an entire year. And add up all of the summer months of water use, and you have enough water to hydrate an entire town. All of this water use has impacts on downstream communities. As upstream communities use more and more, there's less and less for each community further down the river. And it impacts the environment and aquatic wildlife who call those rivers home. Decreasing river flows and stream flows mean less habitat for fish, which has multiplying effects on the ecosystem. And it takes away important food sources for the animals, but also indigenous people and members of the community who have relied on fish as part of their culture for centuries. So what can we do as individuals in order to really make a difference? We can carry water bottles and refillable coffee cups. A second way we can consider making an impact is to create less waste. So let's use an example of plastic bottles. Around the world, 1 million single-use plastic bottles are consumed and discarded every minute. That equates to 500 billion bottles per year and 4 trillion bottles over the past decade. And if you bring all of those bottles together, that would create a mountain nearly the size of Mount St. Helens. And while that plastic mountain won't explode, it has as big as or a more significant impact than Mount St. Helens did when it erupted. Something that we should all consider. Only 50% of bottles are recyclable, only 7% are made into new bottles, and communities around the country have stopped recycling at all. So I said there were two ways that we can make meaningful change: use less and care more. So let's think about how we might care more. And we want to care more because all of us will be impacted by climate change and some of us in our communities disproportionately. This image provided by Carrie Brooks, professor at Eastern Washington University, shows vehicle emissions along major arteries in Spokane, with the darker blue represent higher emissions. We know that lower income people tend to live along arteries because property values are lower and they're more affordable homes. We know that air pollution is a cause of respiratory illness, which puts people at higher risk of viral diseases like COVID. And it's not just low-income individuals who live in those areas and along those streets who are impacted. It's anybody who uses those streets for transportation. If you ride a bus, ride your bike, or walk to get around on those streets, you're exposed to that air pollution. And you're even exposed and at higher risk if you drive a car, unless you're lucky enough to have an advanced air filtration system in your car. So what can you do? Consider your transportation choices. Do you really need to drive? If you have to run multiple errands, consider combining them into a single trip. More importantly, use alternative transportation, such as riding a bike, walking, riding the bus. And probably the best thing you can do is support the development of infrastructure that makes it easier to use alternative transportation. We can see how our behaviors impact air quality by looking at what's happened through COVID, where fewer people have been driving. In LA, we've seen a decrease in air pollution, and they've enjoyed some of the best air quality of all major cities in the United States. And Delhi, which has some of the chronically worst air quality throughout the world, has enjoyed the best air quality on record. Another way to care more is to think about tree canopy and the impact that has on shade. Spokane has 4 of the 10 poorest zip codes in all of Washington State, and those are shown here. 99201 is the poorest zip code in all of the Pacific Northwest. These zip codes tend to be lower income, tend to have fewer trees, and therefore less shade, which means people who live in these areas are at greater risk of increasing temperatures and extreme heat waves. We should all care about that. And it's not just our community where this is a problem, it's an issue around the world. So compare the map of Spokane, Washington, and Santiago, Chile, and look at the areas that are white and gray, and those are the areas that typically have few to no trees. And I'll let you decide, in looking at those, which parts of the city are more likely to be low income and which parts are likely to be higher income. So what can you do? Plant trees on your own property, support tree planting throughout your community, particularly in low-income neighborhoods, and the best thing you can do is support the integration of affordable housing into all communities, particularly in low-income neighborhoods. But trees grow slowly, so we want to ensure that people have access to shade, so the best way to create equity is to give all people access to shade where it already exists. The third thing you can do to care more is consider your purchasing choices and buy local. This isn't just about economic resiliency, it's also about food security. In Spokane, over 90% of our food comes from somewhere else, despite the fact that our region has some of the best, most fertile soil in the entire country. When we buy locally, nearly 50 times more money is retained in our own economy than if we buy online, where if you spend $100, only $1 is actually retained in your local community, and only then if the driver happens to live there. None of this is a political argument. It's not anti-global, it's not anti-corporate. We live in a global community, which is important, and corporations have a role. This is a human argument. It's about economic resiliency and equity. We've seen what COVID has done to our local economies, with people losing their jobs and businesses being shut. And we know that the economic impacts of climate change won't be any better and will probably be worse because it happens over a longer period of time. So what can you do? Buy from local independently owned businesses. Eat at locally owned restaurants. Their food typically tastes better, and it's easier to find vegetarian options too. Last thing you can do is consider purchasing the majority of your produce and meat and dairy from local farmers. That helps create jobs and improves our own food security. We should all care about how we behave and about climate change. We'll all be impacted. None of us will be spared. It's an issue of equity and an issue of treating each other as humans. The most important thing you can do in the short term is to vote. Vote with your wallet, vote for science, vote for climate leadership both locally and nationally. Local leadership matters too. And vote for people who will use less and care more. Let me leave you with this. In 1975, Muhammad Ali visited Harvard and spoke to a large group of students. And by the end of his talk, a student stood up and asked Ali to give them a poem. And Ali responded with what George Plimpton described as the shortest poem in the world. Ali said, "Me? We." To me, this is the most beautiful poem ever because of the simplicity and complexity of the message. When I first heard it, I imagined it as just 4 letters, me, we. And when you write me on a piece of paper and put a mirror next to it, we is reflected back at you. There's a symmetry. There's a connectedness. They're linked together. Just as I am connected with all of you being in this room and enjoying this experience together, and all of us are connected to the community that we live in. When it comes to climate change, I know how I want to be remembered as a human. How do you want to be remembered? Thanks.